Now let's take a look at how we can find blobs in an image. It turns out that we are going to develop a technique that actually uses the derivatives of images. And so we're going to use some of the tools that we developed for detecting edges. And as with edges, we're going to start with a 1D signal, 1D image, and then we will extend our results to 2D. So first, let's review some of the tools we use for edge detection. First, the Gaussian filter, and the use of the Gaussian filter to reduce noise. So here is your image, f of x, a noisy signal with an edge there. And the way we reduce noise in this case is by convolving it with this Gaussian. Gaussian is n sigma, where sigma is the width of the Gaussian. When you convolve it, you get this result, which is a signal that's more or less free of noise. But of course, the price you pay is at the edge is somewhat blurred. Okay, and so you can find the position of the edge, as you know, by using the first derivative of the image. And instead of applying the first derivative to the image, you can find the first derivative with respect to x of the Gaussian. And that is this function that you see right here, the derivative of the Gaussian. And you can convolve the image with this function, and you end up with this response right here, where you get a clear peak at the location of the edge. We know this. We can also find the edge, as you know, by using the second derivative of the image. Again, instead of finding the second derivative of the image, we find the second derivative of the Gaussian, which looks like this. It's referred to as the inverted Mexican hat operator. Apply this operator to the image and you get this. And here you see that you get a clear zero crossing at the location of the edge. So these are some of the tools that we'll be using for developing our blob detector. So let's look at blobs. So here are 1D blobs of different shapes. And the fact is we want to find all of these as blobs in the image. So first, what we're going to do is to look at a case where you have three blobs. So here is one, we'll call it the image, f of x, 1D, of course, and we have three blobs. And the difference between these blobs is that blob B is 2 times the width of blob A, blob C is 3 times the width of blob A. And here is the Gaussian, because we are going to, of course, need some sort of smoothing here. So we're going to use a Gaussian. In fact, the sigma of the Gaussian is going to be very important in this case, as it's going to allow us to explore what's called the scale space associated with the image. That is different resolutions associated with the image. So that's the sigma right there. And now we're going to use the second derivative of the Gaussian, which looks like this. We just saw this in the previous slides. And if you apply the second derivative of the Gaussian to this image with three blobs, you end up with something that looks like this. So let's take a look at this for a second. Here you see that for blob C, you get exactly what you expect, which is you have blob C is pretty wide. It has two edges, a rising edge and a falling edge. And you see that you get 2 distinct zero crossings. In fact, they are separate from each other. And that's exactly what you would expect from our lecture on edge detection. But when it comes to blob B and blob A, you see that these zero crossing responses begin to overlap. So you get different signals or outputs right here, different shapes. Now, one of the things that we need to fix here is the fact that the response of this operator will depend on the sigma that you use. Because as a sigma gets wider, its peak value begins to fall. And therefore, the response of the operator also reduces with change in sigma. And we are indeed going to change sigma because that's the way we're going to try and find blobs at different scales or different resolutions. So to fix that problem, what we're going to do is multiply the second derivative of the Gaussian with sigma squared. And if you do that, you're going to have what's called a sigma normalized output. And so the second derivative of the image is always going to be sigma normalized. So all that does in our case is to just change the scale here, so to speak, the amplitude of all of these three responses. So now let's get to the interesting part. Let's see what happens as you change the sigma of the Gaussian. So let's say we increase the sigma a little bit, you get this. You see that this response gets much sharper. It actually is a maximum right here. And then this one also goes up, and so does this, but this one is a distinct peak right here. And so that is exactly where the center of this blob lies. So if you can find this peak, you have found this blob. But you haven't found these two blobs, B and C. For that, we continue to increase sigma. When you increase sigma, you see that now this one, blob A, the response begins to reduce now, while blob B goes up and so does blob C. And finally, blob B is going to give you a peak right here. You see that? You get a peak right there. So when you get a peak for blob B, you see that blob A's response has already gone smaller. And then if you keep going with sigma, at some point you're going to get a peak for blob C as well. Right? And blob B and blob A give you smaller responses. And if you keep going, all of them will begin to fall. So this hints at what we need to do. We're going to apply the second derivative of the Gaussian, but apply it for multiple sigmas, a large number of sigmas, and sigma is referred to as scale. And when you do this, irrespective of what the size of the blob is, you're going to sooner or later produce a maximum at that location of the blob, at some scale. So let's take a look at this once again. So you increase sigma, and you find blob A, you further increase sigma, and then at some sigma you find blob B, and then you keep going, and you find blob C. And take a look at these Gaussians right here. This is the Gaussian for which you got a maximum for blob A, this is the Gaussian for blob B, and this is the Gaussian for blob C. And also note the sizes of these Gaussians appear to be proportional to the widths of the blobs themselves. That's an important thing. So now all you need to do to find the blobs in the image is you have this stack of images which correspond to different scales, that is the output of the second derivative of the Gaussian applied to the image but at multiple sigma values. So that's your stack right there. That is described with two parameters. One is x for your spatial coordinate and sigma for your scale. And you're going to find local extrema in this x sigma space. And the x's where the extrema lie correspond to the locations of the blobs. And the sigmas where you have extrema correspond to the scale of the blob itself. So you're getting two pieces of information here. You're not just finding the blobs, you're also figuring out at the same time, you're getting as a side product the size of the blob itself. And this is called the characteristic scale corresponding to a blob. So as I mentioned earlier, different widths here, width one, width two, width three, and indeed you end up with characteristic scale which is proportional to the size of the blob. In fact, in this particular case, we find that for blob A, you get sigma 1. Blob B, you get exactly 2 times sigma 1 because the width is just twice. And blob 3, you get 3 times sigma 1. So remember this, the characteristic scale, very important to blob detection. So now we know how to do blob detection in 1D. You take a 1D signal, image, and you're going to do the sigma normalized second derivative of the Gaussian, and you apply that to the image at many different scales, scales going from sigma 0 all the way to, say, sigma k. So now you have this the stack, and you're going to go in there and find the x sigma pairs for where you have your extrema in the space. And the x star, which is your extremum One particular extremum corresponds to the position of the corresponding blob, and sigma star is the scale or the size of the blob. Okay, very easy to extend to 2D. So here you have the second derivative of the Gaussian is the Laplacian of the Gaussian. And because we need our normalization, it's with sigma, we have normalized Laplacian of Gaussian, which is we'll call the n-log operator. And so what does that mean? You have the Laplacian right here. You have your Gaussian here, 2D Gaussian. You apply the Laplacian to the Gaussian, you get this. You normalize with sigma squared, you get this, which is just a scale version of it. And so what you're going to do is apply the n-log filter to the image, two-dimensional image, with multiple sigma values, and then you're going to end up with a volume, a stack of images where x and y correspond to the spatial coordinates, and sigma corresponds to the third dimension, and then you're simply going to go in there and find extrema in there. Wherever you find a prominent extremum, that gives you the position of a blob, and the scale at which you find it tells you the size of the blob. Okay, so let's explore the scale space that we just talked about, sigma. Let's see what really happens here. So here is an image that's given to you, and let's assume that sigma increases this way. That is, you're blurring the image more and more as you go from left to right. Increasing sigma is what we call increasing the scale, which actually means lowering the resolution of the image. So one way to think about this is that you're going to create a stack of images, which is basically the image I multiply, convolved with Gaussians of different sigma. And that gives you a stack or a three-dimensional function, x, y, sigma, s, x, y, sigma. Important question, what sigma should you use? Well, you can use a very simple expression for that, where sigma k is equal to sigma 0 times s to the power of k. Sigma 0 is the initial scale. That's the first one that you're going to use. And each time, you're going to multiply it with s, a constant multiplier. So let's take a look at a couple of points in the image and how that point responds to the operator, the n-log operator. So let's pick, say, for instance, this point right here in the image, which seems like a fairly rich patch or appearance. And now we're going to plot the result of applying the n-log operator to the image at these different scales. And you get these outputs. And you see for this scale, you get a maximum right here. And the sigma corresponding to that is your characteristic scale, and that represents the size of that feature, the size of that blob. Now, this is an example that tells you that it's not really a blob as in a circle with a firm boundary. It is a blob in the appearance sense. And so it's very hard to look at an image and know exactly how large a blob would end up being when it's extracted by this operator. Now, if you look at a different point, which is on a flat region here, there's nothing much going on here. And so you get these lower values here. There's no extremum per se to call out, and therefore there is no blob in this case. So we can now summarize blob detection in 2D. We're given an image IXY. We convolve the image with the n-log operator at many different scales, and we know we have a simple formula for picking the scales. What you end up with is essentially a stack of images, or you can look at it as a volume. And you're going to go in there and find the extrema in that volume. And each extremum that you find, its position x star, y star, corresponds to the position of a blob. And the sigma that you find at that point corresponds to the size of the blob.